drop the verse. It's going down, fade to Black Street. The homies got at me, collab creations. Bump like agony, no doubt. I put it down, never slouch. As long as my credit can vouch, a dog couldn't catch me. Say, tell me who could stop with Dre making moves, attracting honeys like a magnet, giving them orgasms with my mellow accent. Still moving this flavor with the homies Black Street and Teddy, the original Rough Shakers.
Shutting it down, good lord. Baby got them open all over town. Strictly bitch, you don't play around. Cover much grounds, got game by the town. Getting paid is a forte. Each and every day, true play away. I can't get her out of my mind. I think about the girl all the time. East side to the west side, pushing fat rides, it's no surprise. She got tricks in the stash, stacking up the cash, fast when it comes to the gas. By no means average, it's on when she's got to have it. Baby, you're a perfect 10, I wanna get in, can I get down so I can win? I like the way you work it.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the BT Centre Auditorium. Can you please make sure that you have all mobile devices switched off? There are no fire alarms planned for today, and in the event of an alarm sounding, would you please leave the auditorium by the nearest available fire exit?
Is it that you?
Hello, everybody. My name's Simon Derungs. Good Swiss name. And I'm Head of Marketing Communications here at BT, in our BT Group. And I'd just like to welcome, I'm only going to talk for a minute, I'd just like to welcome you all to this Advertising Association event at BT Centre this evening. It's great to have everyone here, and an especially big welcome to the very brave speakers who are going to be standing up in a minute, to the Advertising Association and to David Aaronovitch, our brave chairman, for the second time. This is the headquarters of BT. I don't know if any of you have been in here before. You know, and when we're not sometimes messing up your broadband connection, we do remain one of the leading telecommunications companies in the world. And in a completely trivial fact, I do bore people at dinner parties with this. We're the oldest communications company in the world. We started as the Electric Telegraph Company in 1846. And we've been going strong ever since, and going from strength to strength. And in fact, many people actually know us best for our advertising. That's often the case. This is often your public face. Looking around, I think most of you are probably too young to remember Maureen Lipman's Ology or Bob Hoskins' It's Good to Talk. Maybe you're aware of more recent work, including the launch of BT Sport. Well, I hope you are, because we spent a lot of money on it. We're an organisation. We're one of the biggest advertisers in the country, and we don't say that as a flippant remark. We believe in the absolute importance of advertising to commercial success, and so we're big supporters of the Advertising Association, and we support a lot of the things they do generally, and especially with their front foot program. Which, as I'm sure you hear a little more about, is there to promote the positive messages around the advertising and creative industries. We're big supporters of them. In fact, our president, our CEO, group CEO, Gavin Patterson, was until recently president of the Advertising Association. So I'd have to say that anyway, of course. It's great to have everyone here today. I'm particularly looking forward to seeing the last one standing, which is kind of an ominous title when you think about it, isn't it? Not least because it seems to be a great initiative for kind of broadening the message to a younger audience. And in fact, I do feel quite old standing here as an aging ad man right here and now. And on that very subject, I'd like to introduce Tim Lefroy.
Very good. Another aging ad man. So my job, thank you, I'll get you later. My job is to thank Simon and BT for hosting us here this evening, to welcome our four gladiators to the exciting task ahead, and thank them very much for coming, to thank you all for coming. And Simon mentioned youth. I'm particularly pleased to see the young brigade over there from Trinity Mirror here to support Victoria. James, welcome. Nice to see you here at another Ad Association event after after quite a little time. And of course, my job, my principal job, is to be the warm-up act for David Aaronovitch, who's the real talent here this evening. Now, David, as Simon alluded, is not a last one standing virgin. He came along and did the event for us at Advertising Week Europe. Was anybody there? Yeah, a few of you were there. Well, then you will know this story because David, we have what I'd like you to do. Actually, you've all been given these things on the way in. Yeah, I'd like you to take those in your right hand, if you'd be so kind. Yeah, these are the mechanisms by which you will vote. And those of you who were there at Ad Week Europe will remember that. That David, with showing great sort of originality, inventiveness, and creativity, discovered that these things didn't work. So he immediately invented something called the Google Arm. And the Google Arm is your own arm, but with one of these attached to it. And so when we actually got to the key bit of voting, you had to raise the arm with this attached, and it was counted in the conventional way. So he said he would come back this evening, but only if we fixed the technology. So we're going to give it a test. We're going to test you as well as the guys in the back there. And so the challenge, and here's a challenge. You've come in past all of our sort of colorful introduction to the Advertising Association and to advertising. We cannot be hurt, okay? You cannot upset us. What I would like you to do is answer this simple question. If you were challenged by anybody to explain the Advertising Association, who we are and what we do, and you could do that and last for more than a minute, you are to vote yes, and that's number one, okay? If you haven't got a clue, there's no shame in that, and as I said, you can't upset us, you are to vote no by pushing number two. And then after you've put your number in, you put the number in and you push send. Okay, so please vote now. I'm just going to check at the back to see whether I've got a thumbs up or not. Guess what? You can't shame us, but we're not going to show you the result. But it is working, and we'll tell you about it later. So I am. That shows precisely how brave I am. Okay. Now I'm going to fill you in briefly. The Advertising Association exists to promote the roles, rights, and responsibility of advertising. That's what we do. We are not the ASA, the Advertising Standards Authority, something completely different. Right? We are not your regulator. We are your industry association. If you're members of the IPA, ISBA, any of the media trade associations, they are part of the AA, and our job is to organize the single voice for advertising here in the UK. And you work for a pretty good industry. Outside, when you leave, you'll have a chance to pick up one of these things, which is called Advertising Pays, which is the original point about our economic value. And in that, you'll find an infographic that says, in 2011, £16 billion spent on advertising in the UK stimulated the economy by £100 billion. That is it's a really meaningful part of what we do for the economy, for society, for people and business. And those of us who are aged, like Simon and me, and have worked in this industry for quite a long time, are actually really quite proud of the industry we work in. And I know sometimes people like to challenge us because we're making people too fat, making people too thin, getting them pissed at the weekends, stealing their data and privacy, commercializing their children, all the things we do, we're supposed to do to people. That just ain't true because responsible advertising is generally a force for good in society. Our job is to get that message out to policymakers, to keep statutory regulation away from our industry and make sure that our own system works really, really well. That's the commercial from your sponsor. We're now going to get on with the fun and get on with the story. I couldn't have more pleasure than to introduce our great chairman for the evening, David Aaronovitch. Thank you.
I have to say, I'm not really very confident about the technology at this point, even now. I'm sure it's going to be fine. No, I've learned a lot already in the last few minutes. AA, that's you, and it's good. ASA is the enemy. Okay, this is really quite straightforward. AA, good, try and make things happen. ASA, bad, try and stop you from doing things and so on, so it's fairly clear. Also very glad to hear about BT, that you were founded in 1846. The organisation I work for, The Times, was founded in 1780, and it really, really sometimes feels like it. We're both venerable organisations who have difficulties sometimes in keeping going, but we do, and we've got stronger, and we've got better, and we've got terrific, and I'd like you to buy copies of The Times and become subscribers and so on, and show The Guardian that their model doesn't work and never will work and is a disaster, please. Thank you. This is, as you've heard, a last one standing, which is a variant on the famous old balloon debate. The balloon debate was so called, for those who don't know, because the conceit is that you are thrown out of a balloon one at a time, voted on if you fail to persuade the audience that you are the person who should remain in the balloon. And so one by one, with a kind of long, despairing wail, you throw somebody out of the balloon and so on. So this is a variant on the balloon debate. It is therefore, as you can see, vicious. It's essentially the same as Monopoly, really. People just got to kind of get sent out, etc. But at least in Monopoly, you're not completely dependent upon what the caprices of an audience, whereas in a balloon debate, last one standing, you certainly are. Now, we work this in stages, right, which is that your first moment of total viciousness comes after you've heard each of the four people I'll introduce in a minute, and you then use this incredibly interesting device, which of course will work beautifully, in order to vote for the person of your choice. The two people with the most votes remain in the balloon. They remain standing. The two people you don't choose and you vote for least, they're chucked out of the balloon. That's it. They're gone completely. And then, after that, you can put questions directly to the two people who are still remaining. And then, at the end of those questions, you'll then decide which one of them measures up to the task and which one of them, essentially, has also got to follow the first two in being thrown out of the balloon. That's essentially what it is. It's really, really vicious. It's extremely nasty. And I think there's really no point in pretending that what we're not involved in here is an absolute cutthroat competition fight to the death. Okay, just, you know, because I did this bit with the speakers beforehand. They were seeking reassurance, as people always do, and you say to them, it'll be fine. It won't be fine. It won't be great. Now, only one of you is going to win, and the other three of you are losers, and that's all the way this is going to be, and so on. Talented losers, quite possibly not, actually, but talented losers, but nevertheless losers, and you are going to decide that. You're going to decide that. I had to say that I looked at the brief, and I'm going to get on with it in a moment, but I looked at the brief that the four people have been given, and it is really is not easy. They're asked for, look for, I mean, you know the brief, which is advertising is dead, long live what? Long live what in this changing, rapidly changing world where the old certainties, which actually aren't that old, but they were certain, are no longer certain in any kind of a way at all, and you have no idea what is going to happen. So what follows? And the three qualities that you have to have is an actionable idea. Love actionable ideas. Sounds like Ed Balls, doesn't it? Or something like that. He almost certainly used the phrase actionable idea in his speech, where Labour has some clear actionable ideas and so on. A motivating delivery, well, he certainly didn't have that today, apparently. And the originality of your idea. Well, it doesn't take a genius to work out that an actionable idea is usually not one which is deeply original, because if it was, it would already have been actioned. But there you are, that's what they've got to do. So let me introduce them to you. I have in front of me a series of interesting biographies, and I have to say, for such young people, they have done absolutely amazing things, probably the same as the rest of you. The first person that you're going to hear from is Tara Austin, who's the senior brand planner at Ogilvy & Mather. But I gather, or is it Mather? Mather. But nobody says Mather, so you wonder what happened to poor old Mather. They just say Ogilvy's, apparently, don't you? And the Mather gets left. Have you ever thought about poor old Mr. Mather? Made the company every bit as much as Mr. Ogilvy, and you don't mention him. But anyway, in her time at the agency, it says here, she's worked on various Unilever accounts, and even I know that that's big, from Dove to Comfort, heard of them, and Hellman's. And it says here she's proud of convincing European housewives to consider the hitherto yucky task of cooking with mayonnaise. What kind of achievement is that? And then it says, most recently, she's been working with Coca-Cola and pitching for new business. Where? On the moon? Who has not heard of Coca-Cola? Who has not got a Coca-Cola available to them if they already want it? This must be a market-saturated brand. I mean, it seems ridiculous to me. You don't want to be working on Coca-Cola. You want to do something more taxing, really. I mean, or maybe that is taxing. Anyway, the second... Well, you can show us what you can do. The second speaker is Aidan O'Callaghan, media planner at Zenith Optimedia. It says here that he spent 3 years there trying to sell beer, trainers, car and drugs. So he sounds a bit like Jesse from Breaking Bad. He worked as a music agent involving booking steel bands to play at weddings and street parties. I think you realised, didn't you, Aidan, that that was making people's lives miserable was no job for you. Very good pedigree, studied history at the University of Manchester and then decided to pursue a career in the media. Snap, Aidan, same as me. History at Manchester, career in the media. You too one day can be as fat as me. And unfortunately, he's a fan of Fulham Football Club and so on. And that is a quite straightforward bid for sympathy, isn't it? Don't give it to him. Vote him only on the basis of what he performs. Monica Poole, who's the marketing manager of new business concepts at Kentucky Fried Chicken. You don't call it that. You call it KFC, don't you? Because presumably because people don't know where Kentucky is and fried is a slightly difficult concept at the moment. But you're proud of the chicken bit. Because you, I mean, it says here that you've worked in chicken for a large part of your professional life and that you're not at all ashamed of having worked in chicken. And it's not your fault if they all live in those terrible sheds and stuff like that. But your chickens almost, they don't. They don't any longer. They roam around. One of my children thinks chickens fly and so on, so they probably think they fly around in the wild, etc. And are then only when they are ready to come to Earth and be killed for our KFC food does that happen. Anyway, she has a current role in strategy and innovation, has her creating, and it says here, new business layers for chickens and product concepts for KFC in the UK. Look very forward very much to hearing you. And finally, Victoria Smith, who's the Creative Solutions Manager at Trinity Mirror. Slight problem, Trinity Mirror is something of a competitor organisations for us, but if she's good, you're going to have to vote for her. She started her media life at Hearst magazines, William Randolph Hearst. You supply story, I'll supply war, he famously said during the Spanish-American War of 1898, or just before it. She pleased her mum, it says here, by taking a role on Good Housekeeping, and fell in love with the delicious treats that were baked up. So actually, you are a kind of, you were sort of Great British Bake Off avant la lettre, weren't you? You knew it was going to happen. You knew it would be big. None of it is any kind of surprise. You are at the cutting edge of domestic bliss in the new form. And this says, after it was no longer possible to eat anymore, she decided to move on to Trinity Mirror, where the pull of large-scale, multi-platform brands won her over. And you see, this is where I had to kind of concede to you, I don't really know what that means. Large scale I can kind of get, but multi-platform is more kind of troubling. But, and this I love, a little known fact about Victoria is that she performed in the opening ceremony of the London Olympics with Dizzy Rascal. That's good, huh? That's very good. So those are our four speakers. They're each going to come up for 10 minutes. They're going to give their pitch. You're going to see which you think is best. You're then going to vote for one on this little machine here, the number 1234, I believe, and then send. So, and I'll remind you of who gets what number when I come up here and give a synopsis of what they've done. And I'm afraid Tara, it can't be delayed any longer. You are the first up, Tara Austin.
Don't start the clock yet, not yet, not yet, not quite. This is me, Tara Austin, senior brand planner at Ogilvy & Mather. I say Mather, you say Mother. Advertising agency, which actually makes answering or finishing this sentence a little bit tricky for me. As far as I know, we're solvent. But you know, despite what people say, I really don't like to be difficult. And this whole exercise presupposes I've signed up to the idea that advertising is dead. Or at least, what I'm imagining we're talking about is the big, fat, fancy pants, TV, broadcasting, billboards, that kind of advertising. The stuff that people recognise is called advertising. And it's dead because people time shift and they're so ad literate and they just avoid it and they ignore it and it's all kind of clever, sneaky, sneaky stuff nowadays. It's content strategies and social media management and new products and services development. That's the kind of stuff we do now. Yeah, but I could stand up here and spiel out a bunch of stuff that you possibly suspect could maybe be true, or I could say something quite ridiculous. I could do what advertising does and maybe give you a new thought you'd never had before, points for bravery and all that, and say something hopefully a little bit more interesting. So here it is. Advertising is dead. Long live the Queen. Bear with me here. The Queen. She is everywhere. She's on every note and coin in your pocket, on every stamp you send. And frankly, she owns Christmas. So this is a monumental brand, a brand that built empires. And she's not going anywhere. But why, I hear you ask, is it that if advertising is dead, why on earth do we need her? After all, she doesn't interact with the youth, that all-important next generation of consumers. She's not replying to my tweets. And quite frankly, you know, you could say she's as old-fashioned advertising itself. And that might be true. But if we're dead and gone, I think she's one of the only things left filling the great big gap that we've left behind. And that's because she exists to fulfill at least one, there are others, but at least one very good function. She bonds us. She bonds us just by existing, just by being there. She's part of the cultural glue that holds us together. And she does this in two important ways. First of all, she's common. She's the commonest woman in the Commonwealth. Points for jokes also, even if they're terrible. Black, white, rich, poor, ugly, watching Jeremy Kyle or starring in it, we are all her target audience. She does not discriminate. We are all her subjects. But it's very, very difficult to keep that kind of common relevancy, that common currency, to keep the attention of a nation. And so she does it in creative ways, like procreating. And she actually did a bit of crowdsourcing for this logo up here. She lived for 60 years, got coronated more than that, actually. She's lived for 88 years now. And of course, as well as the pomp and ceremony, there are other hijinks. But she keeps her common currency alive. But there is another aspect of why she bonds us, why she's part of this cultural glue that holds us together. And that's really the interesting bit that I'd like to talk about. She is unavoidable. Media placement. She's everywhere. She's on all the notes and the coins and things, but she's also everywhere. Being British is to be her subject. If you want to leave this country, you have to leave through her ports, probably with a passport in which she offers you protection. Of course, you might not like this. You might say, hey, I want a head of state that embodies my values. And how come she gets this cushy job of marching around factories at the age of 88 with her 93-year-old husband when I have to sit at my desk Monday to Friday in my chair with added back support? You know, how come she gets this cushy job? I should at least get to vote on who does it. And that's the really interesting thing, because nobody votes in the Queen. No matter how many likes or not she receives, it won't matter a bit. And that's the really interesting thing about being unavoidable here, because it's not just about being everywhere. It's the fact that you didn't choose for her to be there. Recently, a writer, that's the true nature of being unavoidable. not just being everywhere, but you didn't choose it. Recently, a writer called Matt Honan at Wired magazine wrote a little article, and he conducted a social experiment where he liked everything in his Facebook feed. He only managed 48 hours of doing this. He said that after he liked one initial post, an anti-Israeli post about Gaza, with every further like, his feed shifted further and further to the right until, quite frankly, he was afraid to like anything else in case he ended up on some kind of watch list. But I think his experiment taught us something that we actually all intuitively know about social media. We set up our political and social filter bubbles and they reinforce themselves. The things that we read and watch have become hyper niche and cater to our specific interests. We go down rabbit holes of special interest until we're lost in the Queen's garden, cursing everyone above ground. Now, clearly, I didn't just pick this quote because it has the word Queen in it. I'm not quite that crazy. But I think it's relevant not just to social media, but to the internet writ large. If you go a-Googling, looking for conspiracy theories, you will find them. You will find all... God, there were about 20 different slides I wanted to put up here, different conspiracies, they're brilliant. Anything you want to find the answer to, you can find online. The internet is what you make of it. It's dictated by you. And in contrast, the world of big broadcast TV, advertising, billboards, all that stuff, it's not dictated by you, it's there. It's actually forced upon you. You have no choice but to see it and to know it. And I'd like to illustrate this with a little story. A former friend of mine, okay, he's a boyfriend, he told me a story. He was once sitting behind the glass in a qualitative research group. If you haven't been in one of these rooms, sitting behind the one-way mirror, you frankly haven't lived. But the guy in the room, one of these 45-year-old blokes, gave the standard response, the thing that absolutely everybody who's ever worked in advertising has heard at some point: I don't watch advertising. I've got Sky Plus. Simples. Simples. Dear fellow human being behind the glass in the research room, person I meet at a party, person I'm related to, you may not like advertising and you may believe you don't watch it, you don't see it, but you share the language of the meerkat. You know that it does exactly what it says on the tin. When the sun comes out, you tell your chum it's Pim's o'clock. And you're the one who made Jose Gonzalez a platinum award-winning artist. So I've been terribly distracted by the time Nazis down there. Advertising creates cultural bonds. It creates cultural reference points. It made Father Christmas's outfit red. Sorry, one second. The role of billboard and TV advertising, all of that kind of stuff in the world, is to exist, is to bond us by common jokes, common jingles, common language, common reference points that we all share. This is the stuff that we call our culture, the stuff that is inflicted upon us, that we have no choice but to see and to know and to share. And it's very different from the sort of sneaky, sneaky world of the interwebs, a fragmented world of rabbit holes and ultimately self-perpetuating identities. This stuff bonds granny with grandson, husband and wife, you and me and everyone. The amazing thing about advertising, the reason I still work in this industry that still makes big, beautiful brand campaigns, is that people might not like it, but in making something that is creatively common, making brands relevant for everyone, and in doing it in a way that it's everywhere, whether you choose to see it or not, actually what we do is create cultural bonds. That's my belief. That's why I'm still doing this. That's why I love it. And that matters. It's meaningful. We create meaningful stuff. It might not matter to you that Father Christmas's outfit is red, and God forbid, the Queen may not matter to you, and the meerkat may not matter to you, but you would miss all these things if they weren't there. If the world was full of human strangers that had no common language, no common jokes, no common cultural starting point, we need to make more of that stuff of cultural bonds. Not all advertising does it, but we should do more of it. Actionable point for you there. Advertising isn't dead. Its shoes are too big to fill. But if it were, God help us all and long live the Queen. Thank you very much.
Ten minutes. Well done.
Look at that.
Bit of prep there. Hi, I'm Aidan, and I am here today to contend that advertising is dead. Long live bribery. Now, I know what you're all thinking. I hope this is what you're thinking anyway. There's always one who comes up with a ridiculous, overstated title and then has to spend 10 minutes trying to justify it. Well, that person is me. I'm going to do my best to show you why bribery is the way forward. In a world where advertising has changed so much, rather than thinking about the ad we should be creating, instead we should be thinking about the bribe we're going to offer our consumers. Bear with me, please. And hopefully I'll do so without actually being sued for defamation as well, but hopefully that association will pay for that if that does happen. So, there was a golden age of advertising, which began in the 1960s alongside the ubiquitous take-up of TV. Now, back in the 1960s, if you had a communications problem, the answer was relatively simple. As long as you could afford it, create a TV ad, and you knew you'd reach millions of people. This was a time when 20 million people every night were watching Coronation Street. You knew it would have a short-term impact on sales, and you knew that it would help to build your brand in the longer term. It's no coincidence that a number of the big brands that we know today all started in the 1960s with adverts like this. Now, obviously, all of us in this room know this has changed a huge amount since then. And I believe there are two key factors that have led to that change. The first is media fragmentation. And if anyone's wondering what the hell this picture is, these are ancient fragments of media. You get that? I mean, if anyone can find a better way to represent media fragmentation, and please tell me, because this is probably what I worked hardest on finding this picture. And I admit, it is terrible. It is absolutely terrible. But bear with me. Media fragmentation. So, back in the 1960s, there was one commercial TV station. Now, there are hundreds, and some are great, and there's a lot of awful ones. But there's loads of TV stations out there. On top of that, there's thousands and thousands of advertising touchpoints out there, meaning that every single day, consumers are bombarded with millions of adverts. And it's just become so much more difficult to make consumers take notice of our advertising. We have to work so much harder. The second factor is obviously technological advance, and there's loads of different ways that technological advance has affected our industry, and actually, amazingly, some of them are actually even more interesting than search engine marketing, amazingly so. Sorry to any search people out there, don't mean it. The way that I think this has been most key is that technological advances have meant that consumers have become empowered. Right, we've got no God-given right now to assume that when we put an advert out there, they're going to sit there and listen to it. So we have to do something more than that. We have to somehow reward people for their attention. We have to give them something in return. So all of that means there are two things that any communications campaign has to do. The first is offer some kind of cut-through. Cut through all that advertising clutter. And the second is offer a value exchange to make people feel rewarded for their time. Now, advertising in its traditional format can still do that in some ways. But I'll tell you something, a bribe can do it better. And let me tell you what, the right bribe at the right time can definitely provide cut through to the right person, and a bribe by its very nature is a value exchange. That's the whole point of it. So, to define bribery. The Oxford English Dictionary defines a bribe as to dishonestly persuade someone to act in one favour by a gift of money or other inducement. Now, to deconstruct this, most of us in this room would probably in some way object to dishonestly part of it, most of the time, I would imagine, but I'm going to take a broad definition of this. We're all in the business of persuading people to act in our favour, and I'm going to try and argue now, bear with me again, that we should be doing that now by a gift of money or other inducement. And I'm going to show you some examples. I'm going to show you some examples of advertisers that are already doing so. So this is Brian. Brian's the friendly confused.com robot who is currently doing the rounds. He's roaming the country, attempting to bribe the population with £1 million. A fantastic offer, I'm sure you'll all admit. Now, all you have to do to get a chance of winning this £1 million is go and buy some insurance, right? Easy. You can almost imagine when you're sitting on the confused.com website, you can imagine Brian's voice in your head, and I'm not going to try and do an impression, but you can imagine him saying to you, go on, go for it. Go on, just it's £1 million, it will change your life. Of course it's legitimate, we've got a massive check, just like children in need do. Now, I should point out at this stage that the confused.com offer is absolutely legitimate. And it's actually one that's persuaded me to act recently. I updated my contents insurance through confused.com, and I'd appreciate it all if you would keep your fingers crossed for me, because I may be in for £1 million, and I never have to do this again, so fantastic. Anyway, confused.com, that's a great example. In America earlier this year, Newcastle Brown Ale were even more explicit in the way they tried to bribe their consumer base. I'm going to show you a quick video now of how they did that.
Do you like money? Do you have a Twitter account? Then click on follow Newcastle on Twitter and we'll send you money. We're sending out lots of money in the form of checks. Who still uses checks? We do, but that's not important. What's important is the amount. Follow Newcastle on Twitter and we'll send you a check for one full dollar. Sure, we could come up with a cool fan contest, create exclusive content, or make up a unique hashtag. But that takes a lot of work, and it's summer, and we'd rather just get out of here. Why endure the unsolicited marketing of other beer brands for free when you could endure Newcastle's unsolicited marketing and get paid? So, follow Newcastle on Twitter at follownewcastleontwitter.com to get your dollar.
So the opening line of that video was, do you like money? Now, if there's ever been a more obvious opening to a bribe, then I'd like to see the example. You don't have to bribe people with money, though. Go into any supermarket today and look down the aisles and look at all the categories. And in each category, you'll probably find at least one brand attempting to bribe consumers with some kind of a gift. The example here is Lambrini looking to bribe people, a fantastic bribe, with a copy of Heat magazine with every bottle that you buy. I mean, Lambrini and Heat magazine is my idea of a perfect Friday night in, so I'm sure it persuades a lot of people too. Why not bribe people with a gift if it's not going to be cash? Those are two examples of physical bribes. We can also bribe people with other things. So Red Bull in recent years have become absolute masters at bribing people with experiences. So whether it's the Red Bull Flugtag, whether it is the air race, whether it's the cliff diving world championships. They create events and experiences that they know consumers want to attend. You can go along for free, watch some amazing stuff. The only catch is you have to spend the entire day consuming the Red Bull brand. After the experience, you can go onto YouTube, maybe, if you've missed the experience, and watch all the content they've got back from those events. Again, all you have to do is endure a bit of Red Bull marketing along the way. But that's absolutely fine, because you get something in exchange. So the bribery there is an experience, or it might be some form of content. A more recent trend is of brands looking to bribe consumers with some kind of a utility. Make something that's useful, and consumers will come and start to use it, and in the process experience your brand. The example here is Nike Plus, which is a fantastic app that's been downloaded in its millions. Because it's so great, people love to use it because it is really useful, it helps them out. Now, don't think that Nike have created this because they're desperate for you to become fit and healthy. I mean, that's a nice side effect, of course. But the reason is because if you've downloaded the app, you're going to be exposed to them at least once a week. You're going to be thinking about Nike whenever you go out for a run. And the next time you buy your shoes, your trainers, which shoes work best with the Nike Plus app? Don't have to answer that question. So again, you could look to bribe your consumer base with some kind of utility. So to sum up everything I've just said, and I realize this is pretty out there, so thanks for bearing with me. Basically, in an age where it's so much more difficult to cut through to consumers and they're expecting some kind of value exchange, an old-fashioned traditional advert won't work in the way that it used to. And instead, we should be thinking about bribery. Now, the bribe you offer to consumers can be anything, anything that might persuade them to consider you and to consider buying you. It could well be a gift like Lambrini and Heat magazine. It could be an experience or some kind of content like Red Bull. It could be a utility like Nike Plus, or it could well be a gift of cold hard cash like Newcastle Brown Ale did. So hopefully that has helped to persuade you that bribery is the key in the future. But in case it hasn't, I'm going to try something out here. I have got with me a bribe. Now, you hear that? That is a lot of coins. That's a lot of coins. So, I've tried this out. It might not work. If it doesn't work, then that's probably good on you. But basically, this is a competition. Anyone who is willing to accept my bribe, and by the way, this isn't just coins. There's also some content in here. It's a printout of that fantastic presentation you've just seen. You can take that away with you. Anyone who's willing to commit their vote to me right now, put your hands up and you'll win a share of this massive bribe. Anyone willing? Thank. Oh, yeah, loads of people. Excellent. That, wow, that's a lot of votes. Okay. Probably not enough money to go around in here, but thanks very much anyway. All of you guys, I'll meet you at the end over here and I'll give you the cash and the content. You have to share maybe a couple of slides each of the content. And the rest of you, thank you for being so honest. You either thought that it wasn't worth the bribe, you're really honest people, or the presentation was crap. Either way, thanks very much for listening.
Good evening, everyone. I'm going to offer up a third perspective tonight, which says advertising is dead, or at the very least, I think its days are highly numbered. And I say advertising is dead, and long live Ubuntu. And if there are any South Africans in the room tonight, you'll be familiar with what this term means. And for those of you who are not, I will be explaining it in a moment. But I think tonight we're really being asked to cast our minds forward and look into the future, and we're asking ourselves, how will we sell and how will we persuade people to buy our brands in the future? How are we going to win share of minds and share of hearts in a world of kind of mass consumerism where consumers are just being bombarded with information? They have too much choice, too much content, so much entertainment to choose from. How are we going to create real meaning and connection where they're already screening us out because they're binge watching 8 hours of Breaking Bad on the weekend? And I think, you know, creating real meaning and connection is going to be the key and is going to be the answer to the future. And I think the answer lies in asking ourselves, well, you know, why do brands exist in the first place? And I don't know how many of you, you know, when you're on your way to work in the morning, have questioned that idea of, well, what is the real meaning of what I'm about to go and do today? Like, what is that deeper meaning? Is there anyone here who's questioned why they do the work that they do? Hands up. Very good. You know, you've heard, I've been selling chicken for a really long time. And I question that deeper meaning around what is this work that I'm doing? I've had that question many times. And I think if we go back to the heart of it, brands exist to meet people's needs. That's what we're really doing. That's what draws them to us. I came across a brilliant paper by the great Michael Porter. It was a Harvard paper where he talks about, you know, if brands are in the business of meeting people's needs, then why are the greatest societal needs, why do those remain unmet? And why do we rely on governments and NGOs to meet those needs when at the heart of it, we already have these amazing business models there that are creative and innovative, designed to meet people's needs, and we do it at a profit? And he poses the question that, what if brands were to make it their business to meet society's greater needs? What if we did that and moved that away from corporate social investment, made it part of our core mission, and we would find a way to do that and make a profit. We would find a way to do that and find creative, innovative products and solutions that would address this massive demand. Bless you. There's another study by Jim Stengel, the author of Grow, and he was really curious about, you know, why do some brands grow and outperform the market and grow ahead of the competition? And he conducted a study over a period of 10 years, taking 50,000 brands into account. And he managed to prove that the brands that really managed to consistently outperform their competitors were the ones that at their very heart and at their very core had a greater ideal. They had a higher purpose that was galvanizing their business to say, we're really genuinely about the business of improving people's lives. And these are companies like Coca-Cola, a higher purpose of bringing happiness to the world. Dove, it has a higher purpose of impacting society and saying, you know, we're going to help build women's self-esteem. And he came up with the Stengel Top 50, which said if you'd invested in those top 50 companies that had a higher purpose at the heart of what they do, you would have earned a return 400% greater than the Standard & Poor 500 top companies. So he met this idea around brands of purpose and really galvanizing that to meet society's needs, that has a deep resonance with me. I come from South Africa, yes, chicken girl from Africa. And, you know, in considering this whole debate and this whole puzzle, I can't help but look back to the country that I come from and wonder if there isn't some inspiration that lies there. Now, South Africa is a country that is, it's a young country. It's full of potential and possibility, but there's also this contrast where it is characterized by chaos and turmoil. And these come about largely because of these great big unmet societal needs. This is a picture of strike action for, you know, people in a community who haven't received their basic services. So it's kind of like paying your council tax and Haringey Council just doesn't provide your water. So it's kind of unimaginable. But in this country of contrast, this land of potential and opportunity and this contrast of chaos, there also lies a really beautiful philosophy that sits between that. And that philosophy is called Ubuntu, and it's a way of seeing the world. And at the very, in its most basic explanation, Ubuntu means I am because of you. And when you say that enough times, I am because of you, you understand the meaning of it, that it creates a continuous circle. It helps you understand from the inside that my well-being is deeply tied to your well-being, and that in a more collective society, we realize that, you know, beyond that veil of separation, we're all deeply connected. So this means, you know, none of us wins unless all of us wins. And from a business point of view, how can my business truly prosper and grow in the future if my community that I serve, the community that I operate in, doesn't grow as well? So thinking through Ubuntu's approach, you know, I'm really fascinated by that idea, but what if we made it our business to really take on and work on society's greater needs? And what if we aligned our brand purpose together with what we're really good at in business and created this virtuous circle, this continuous circle that reinforces itself and reinforces that benefit? I love Pampers as a brand example. You know, I kind of think of if Pampers had stood back and said, I'm going to think about this from an Ubuntu perspective, and they said, I am because of you, they'd realize I am or I exist not because of nappies, but because I exist because of the picture that's up there, because we're actually about babies and baby development and helping mom help their babies develop and grow. And this was a very successful case study where the company completely galvanized themselves around that idea. And they said, well, if we're about helping moms help their babies grow and develop, how do we align that to a bigger societal need? And the reality being that in third world countries, moms don't get to have that benefit. Often they don't have access to medical care or vaccinations in this case. And they developed the Pampers One Pack, One Vaccine campaign, which was not a CSR program. It was not a marketing idea, but they made it integral and core to their whole business that says, let's have moms in first world countries helping moms in third world countries and creating this continuous circle of growth and connection. Another example is American Express, which again said, we're in the business of helping realize that people's dreams, but let's think about the shop owner and the small shop owner. They developed a campaign around shop small and supporting your local business in your communities, which is also beneficial to American Express generating more transactions. And then thirdly, this is an example which again is close to home for me. You knew I was going to bring it back to chicken, but this is KFC South Africa and a campaign called Add Hope, which is around helping feed hungry children in communities in South Africa. And I find it really powerful because I've seen it move from something that sat on the periphery as a CSI campaign and was brought kind of front and center, integrated through the product, through the brand, through the experience. And I've seen, you know, consumers literally buying hope alongside chicken. And I'm gonna play a video for you which will bring the idea to life. But you know, South Africa is a market where you say that you work for KFC and people will literally give you a high five because they're so pleased and excited that you do, because it's such a part of the community, whereas that doesn't happen in the UK. And the brand is, you know, as loved as Coca-Cola and bigger than McDonald's, and it has these really high employee pride scores because of this initiative. So I'm going to play a video, and I think for the creators in the room, you know, when you're operating this space, it becomes less about advertising, but more about sharing meaningful and really rich stories. So if we could play the video, please.
This is Rion Mansa, extreme adventurer, the only man who cycled around Africa alone and kayaked the Arctic. In 2012, he undertook another challenge, to cycle across South Africa. It should have been easy, but this time there was one big difference. This time, he was starving himself. To show people the crippling effects of hunger on South Africa's children, Rion embarked on a 6-week cross-country expedition on half the calories his body needed.
The wind just stealed calorie after calorie after calorie. It's impossible.
From satellite view, the 4,100 kilometer route spelled out the word hope, a reminder that a solution to child hunger exists.
Add hope.
Add hope.
Add hope. KFC CSI and an in-store mechanic that lets customers donate 2 rand to feed a hungry child. Rion's struggle demonstrated what happens to the human body when starved or fed. 1.23 million people watched as he battled against the elements, the road, and his own body. He stopped at charities in 5 provinces where he ate what the children did. People could tweet him extra calories, but Rion didn't take them, leaving this as his only real source of sustenance. Each time, the effects were almost instantaneous. Rion was happier, stronger, and faster. One meal made all the difference.
Journey of Hope.
Rion then said,
losing 14 kilograms.
Feeding SA's hungry children.
I was weak, I had hunger pains.
I'd like to end on a quote from this man who really understood the concept of Ubuntu, and he had the vision to see how it would help grow communities, individuals, and could really transform business and the growth in the country. And he said, Ubuntu does not mean that people should not enrich themselves. The question is, are you going to do so in order to enable the community around you and enable it to improve? And if you can do that, then that's a very important thing. Thank you.
Hi everyone, I'm Victoria from Trinity Mirror. I'm going to attempt to follow these three amazing talks. I'll get straight to it. So the brief was, advertising is dead, long live, fill in the blank. I'm not going to lie to you, I was pretty angry when I received this brief. Advertising is dead. Yeah, I can't say that. I work in advertising. I mean, it's a £17.8 billion industry in the UK, which is set to rise by 7.5% this year. So it's far from dead. Yeah, and I didn't want to stand up here and argue myself out of a job either. But advertising has evolved, and that evolution seems to have sped up dramatically in recent years. Now, I won't take you back to the first newspaper announcements of the 1700s, or the first colour print ad for Dewar's Whiskey in 1936 for the Daily Record. But when the internet became widely available in the early to mid-90s, the evolution of advertising went into fast forward. From social media, from email marketing to social media to digital display to mobile and app advertising, the list goes on and on. It's too many to mention today, and there will be for the foreseeable future. But whilst the practice of advertising is as strong as ever, I think that there's an issue with the definition of advertising. It seems a lot of people have very varied opinions on what the definition of advertising is. So, where better to start than asking the industry itself? And I did get to have a little bit of fun here. I asked a number of my media owner colleagues what the definition of advertising is. This is where they all get a bit scared. They decided that advertising is a job for masking alcoholism, a career for people with geography degrees, brilliant, and a tool to help sell crap to consumers. Thanks, guys. Luckily for them, I won't name and shame them here today. I did also ask a number of media agencies as well for their definition. They decided that advertising is an attempt at selling their product or service as a dream to an unsuspecting audience. It's inspiration to help you spend your cash. I mean, why else would anyone buy oxygenated beauty water and beautifying snail slime? Yeah. And finally, absolutely effing everywhere. From an advertising agency. And I did ask a client the same question as well. And I think, unsurprisingly, the client answered, advertising is all about being first. But I did have a look on the IPA's website and what their definition of advertising was. And under their definition, it states, increasingly though, definitions of advertising have had to take on board new communications opportunities. The explosion of media channel opportunities, including social, have made the advertising environment much more complex. So even the Institute for Practitioners in Advertising can't decide. No. But whilst I stand here debating the definition of the word, it does seem that we're a rather self-indulgent industry and have actually completely forgotten to ask the people who matter, the consumers. I'm lucky enough to have access at work to a consumer research panel called Mouthpiece. And I asked a panel of consumers a variety of questions from what have you been discussing in the last week with friends or family to would the world be a better place without advertising? The results were pretty conclusive. In the last month, 27% had spoken with friends or family about an advert that they'd seen. And when asked about other advertising, a resounding 59% had spoken about the ice bucket challenge in the last week alone. I was surprised to find they were savvy enough to identify as advertising. And yes, yeah, that's me doing my ice bucket challenge there. To touch on a few other ads mentioned, there was a wide variety. The meerkats featured heavily as being funny and original, and they spoke with friends and family about how cute they are. One respondent recalled the Lidl ad fondly, as it showed their high-quality products at lower prices. So it was the information that she gained that encouraged ad recall here. To touch on a few others mentioned, there was Mo Farah in the corn ad. We had the dancing pony for three. Should have gone to Specsavers for that infamous Suarez bite in the World Cup. And Iceland for their price-led adverts. But from sifting through all these results, it becomes increasingly apparent that consumers are likely to recall ads that are either relevant, entertaining, or informative. And to touch on informative for a second, an independent agency discovered that over one in three consumers find adverts helpful when deciding what products to buy. And really interestingly, that number shoots up to over 51% when asking the exact same question of 18 to 34-year-olds. So we're clearly moving in the right direction. But back to the matter in hand. And I did ask our panel what their definition of advertising was. We had a number of similar responses, such as making people aware of a service or product and encouraging them to purchase it, and information about goods or services for sale. There was a couple of negative responses, such as interruptions to my television programmes and lots of media hype about stuff I don't want to know about. But I'm sure those respondents would feel differently if all the adverts they saw were relevant and informative for them. And in fact, when I asked them if advertising was a good or bad thing, only 8% said that it was a bad thing. And luckily for all of us, it was a resounding no when asked if the world would be a better place without advertising. And a colleague of mine backed this up really nicely the other day. I was speaking to Rupert Howell, who's a former president of the IPA, and he was telling me about the time he visited Moscow in 1989 before advertising was permitted. He said the city was grey, dull, and quite frankly, pretty scary. But fast forward 15 years later, and he visited a totally different Moscow, a hugely colourful city and really, really vibrant, largely thanks to advertising. It was a sign of the free world, and consumers welcomed it. And I mean, the industry went into panic with the release of digital television recorders, petrified that everyone was going to skip all the adverts. But people didn't buy these boxes to skip the ads. They bought them just to find content that they wanted to watch. According to Skyview panel data, only 17% of viewing is actually time-shifted. And of that, 30% still watch the adverts at normal speed anyway. Channel 4 made a TV programme called The 100 Greatest TV Ads. 3.3 million people tuned in to watch that. An entire programme just on adverts, and more have been made since as well. Just to touch on that also, I was at Proms in the Park the other week as well, and I just overheard an audience member say, oh, I really like it when they play stuff from the ads. And then, to go back to that, the dancing pony for three, that's had 9.5 million hits on YouTube. That's people actively seeking out that advert to watch. So firstly, if consumers don't differentiate between the forms of advertising, whether it's native, content, display, mobile, digital, etc., etc., and secondly, they don't see it as a bad thing, Then why as an industry are we encouraging them that it is? We're constantly asking consumers if they want to skip ad or click the cross in the corner to get rid of me, get this content for free if you watch this advert, and the much used 10 seconds to go, 9, 8, etc., etc. Cindy Gallup sums this up really well. She said, what all these messages all communicate is that advertising is a very bad thing, that people need to be tricked, cajoled, and deceived into watching it. So as an industry that's guilty of creating this chaos around the definition, we need to stop being so apologetic and live up to our responsibility. We need to stop offering mixed messages and stop encouraging negativity such as skip ad. We need to stop being so self-indulgent about what the word means to us as an industry and embrace it in all of its brazen glory, because this is what has led to the confusion in the definition of advertising. And it could be detrimental at a time when advertising is evolving rapidly and clearly moving in the right direction. So my answer to the brief is twofold. Advertising is dead. Long live the evolution of advertising. The practice of advertising has evolved since its humble beginnings and will continue to do so. However, we need to put ourselves in the consumer's shoes and stop overanalyzing the definition. We need to evolve at the same speed as the consumer and accept the ever-broadening definition, because they are the reason that we're here. They are the reason that our industry continues to thrive. And they are how I know my job in advertising will still exist in 30 years' time. Thank you very much.
Okay, that really took some guts. All of it. I'm going to remind you very briefly of the four presentations that you've seen, because it's now quite a long time since the first one, and it's fair to do that. And then you're going to vote. And just to let you know, obviously, that Tara Austin will be number one, Aidan O'Callaghan will be number two, Monica Poole will be number three, and Victoria Smith will be number four. And after you've pressed, you then press the thing with send, and don't all do it now, because otherwise what's the point of what I'm about to say? Honestly, it's ill-disciplined rabble. I found that some of this sort of remarkably brilliant, but you do have to remember that these have got to be actionable. Some of them were on the verge of actionable in a completely different way. You could actually take legal action against some of the presentations that were here, but let's just talk about that. And they've got to be interesting, and they've got to be vividly delivered. Well, they were certainly all vividly delivered. First, we had Tara Austin's Advertising is Dead, Long Live the Queen. Lovely observation there about cultural bonding and so on. One memorable phrase for me, culture is what is inflicted upon us. In other words, we don't get to choose it ourselves. Of course, once upon a time, you never did get to choose anything yourself, so everything was culture. And now there's this big thing which is not culture. I particularly enjoyed, Tara, your Meryl Streep in the Prada film, if you remember. This is the kind of advertisement where Meryl Streep, as the editrix, says to the dowdy PA, "You think fashion is nothing to do with you, but you see the colour of the thing that you're wearing." Tara, you did exactly that about advertising. You think you're unaffected by advertising, but let me tell you that you actually are. Very good observation, incredibly annoying, but nevertheless true. So that's Tara's argument. Aidan's argument was disgraceful. There's no way about it. Long live bribery and so on. I like the joke about media fragmentation with that bit of fragment. So just obviously put it in Google, fragment, and that came up. And then he put the picture in and so on. It really worked for him. And not only that, He actually tried to get your sympathy as a consequence of using it, which just shows you how talented he is at using everything that he has available to him. I couldn't help thinking that if you seriously wanted to bribe people to buy products, then in that case, to offer them online pornography probably is the most successful tactic that you're providing. You could convince them completely that nobody would ever find out about it. It would be very good. But I was on the verge of disqualifying you, actually, for what you did at the end, until I remembered that this is a marketing strategy very much like that used by News Corporation in order to get people into in with the Premier League goals on the app, and so I've decided, actually, that you'd better stay in. Monica Poole's argument was Ubuntu and so on, and it was the presentation that made you feel that there really had already been a soundtrack written for it and scored by Elton John. The Circle of Life was very much present and so on. As I understood the presentation, Monica, what you were saying was, is you should sell Kentucky Fried Chicken on the basis that you'll be able to feed the children of Africa. And I think that is a very big argument. I will certainly am prepared to buy products on the basis that the whole of the world will be better. If you could get me a product which will solve climate change or something like that, then I am quite prepared to buy that and so on. And I thought it was a very interesting argument. And then Victoria Smith's, what I can only describe as a piece of defiance, really, and so on. What is all this nonsense about the death of advertising? We still rake in billions of pounds, and it's growing. Stop being apologetic and make people sit through all our interminable ads and make so that they can't click off. Well, it's interesting. It's a risk. You have to decide when voting for it whether it's actionable, in the sense that if you did do that, whether a whole lot of people like me with attention spans of about 8 milliseconds wouldn't just actually stop watching all the videos and do something else instead. That's for you to decide. Those are our four, and very brilliantly are two. You're going to now whittle them down to two by voting. Now, vote. One for Tara, two for Aidan, three for Monica, four for Victoria, and send at the end. And I'm hoping that something will eventually come up here and it will tell us who the two other people are. Oh, somebody's going to come down. Somebody's going to come down and they're going to give me an envelope. Votes are still coming. This prompt has just arrived here. Votes are still coming in. We will let you know when the vote has closed. And then where it could advise me about what to do in the meantime, it's completely blank. There is nothing, there's absolutely nothing there at all. And on the speaker's briefing notes, there's absolutely nothing about any such conceivable delay. So we have a number of options. One possibility is that we now sing The Circle of Life while we go, which is quite a thing. A lot of you will remember it very well. I imagine, looking at your ages, that you're almost exactly of the age to have gone to see it in the cinema when you were six. Who hasn't seen The Lion King? Who hasn't seen The Lion King? Okay, right. You haven't seen The Lion King. Okay, could you stand up and give us a rendition of The Circle of... No, you can't either. How can you not have seen The Circle of Life? The Lion King? Okay, I mean, that just goes to show you. Right, what we have is a very elegant electronic device here. Okay. Now, I'm going to presume, Sapphire, that these are the two people who have got through to the next stage. They are. They, OK. Right. You have, in the most vicious way, I'm afraid, kicked out Tara and Victoria. That's what you've done. I know. Well, you did it. I mean, don't bloody complain to me. It's your vote. I didn't even exercise a vote. How could I? And so on. Which means that the two people that we have left are Aidan and Monica. So Aidan and Monica, if you'd like to join me on the stage. Well done. I mean, I'm not just saying this, but I thought everybody was absolutely brilliant. But this bit of murder has to happen, and there's still more murder to come. So it's your opportunity now to question these two people about their ideas, about the value and the possibility of bribery versus Ubuntu. And actually, now I come to think about it, this is, you're being offered the most significant kind of moral difference choice. The presentation of this man ended with him offering you money in an envelope, and the presentation of this woman offered you Nelson Mandela. So we have some real contrast here, but it's now for you to kind of tease out things like the actionability of it and so on. There's a great thought here, which is whether you could get Nelson Mandela or successor or one of those to actually do a Kentucky Fried, a KFC ad. Okay, who would like to ask a question? Yes, here.
So it's a question for Monica. There's a lot of boards still that would not believe that doing something good as a brand will actually bring you money. What's your response to it?
Well, I've seen it in operation, and I think that what happens is that when you're in the business of doing good, it doesn't need to be completely altruistic. So as a business, you're still doing it because you know that you want to make a profit. But it does create a connection with consumers, which places their brand more deeply, I think, in their minds and in their hearts than versus not doing it. So my experience has seen that when it's genuine and authentic, and I think people can see through that if it's kind of a tag on or if it's just this thing that you're doing as a token gesture, but when it is genuine and authentic and it really connects emotionally, it does help you connect more, which helps you sell more. And it does become this virtuous circle which reinforces itself. So I think it does grow your profitability as well.
I'll tell you something else that connects emotionally. A bribe.
Okay. High strategy, low strategy. It's interesting, isn't it? Okay, yes, please.
I have a question, again, for Monica. Do you think that some companies and organisations can better afford Ubuntu than others? Can the likes of Coca-Cola and KFC afford to take that moral high ground and profit from it, as you might argue, than companies that are starting out and trying to cut their niche in the commercial world?
I think that actually, if you're starting out, the opportunity is probably even greater for you, because you're not trying to change the tide or change, you know, turn this beast of an organization towards making that their core and their center. So in the world of KFC or Coca-Cola, it's a journey, it's an evolution that they're on of moving something from what used to sit as corporate social investment on the sidelines to becoming front and center and core to what they do. That's quite difficult. There's so much you need to do to change mindsets, stakeholders in the business. And I think starting out, if you can start out with that outlook, where you say, we're going to take our talent, what we're really, really good at as a business, and we're going to align that to meeting a greater societal need. I think you're starting out from a really powerful platform.
I'll tell you something that any company can afford to do. I'm not going to keep doing it.
Okay, I think we need a question for Aidan. Is this a question for Aidan? Yeah. Microphone coming.
It was just a point, really, so I'm going against the format, but is Ubuntu not an emotional bribe? And Aidan's just talking about a monetary bribe. So it feels like we're actually on the topic of bribery. It's just which bribery is most compelling and easiest to do.
You know, when you said, is Ubuntu not an emotional bribe? To me, that had a question mark on the end. I mean, call me kind of old-fashioned. That's a perfectly decent question. Is Ubuntu not an emotional bribe? Yeah.
Well, so the definition of bribery I was talking about wasn't just cash. I hope I made that vaguely clear, even though at the end, I did let myself down hugely by trying to bribe the audience, and again, I apologise for that. I think you're absolutely right. Bribery can encompass a huge range of different things. I tried to articulate a few of them. Obviously, I haven't articulated everything. It could be gifts, it could be cash, it could be anything. And why not bribe people emotionally? I think that's a very fair point. Whether Ubuntu is, I wouldn't like to disgrace
why,
it.
Well, no, why wouldn't you?
Why wouldn't I?
Yeah, why wouldn't you?
Why wouldn't I want to disgrace it? Just doesn't seem fair, does it? I am really not on the moral high ground here. I should really step back and let Monica answer that.
I don't think it's an emotional bribe. And again, it's about doing it with authenticity. So I think, you know, consumers will buy into brands that share their values. So you'll attract a group of people that share the same values. And, you know, if we're in business, you know, we kind of, you know, when a brand is starting out as the little guy, we love them. And then they become the big corporate and we think that they're evil. But actually the big corporates are the ones that have just excess resource. So why not channel that into doing something good and making a difference? So I don't think it's an emotional bribe if done authentically.
Okay, I'm going to remember that. yes. Is there somebody over there? Yeah, over there.
Hi. Oh, microphone. Aidan, just to contention, I suppose, it's linked to the previous question, which is that is bribery not really what advertising has sort of always done? You know, it would have been perhaps a sort of 30-second slice of entertainment, or it would have been, you know, a piece of information that you didn't have before. I suppose if the phrase is advertising is dead, long live bribery, was that not? Does that make sense if bribery has always been what advertising is?
Yeah, that's a fair point. So I guess maybe good advertising has always been about bribing consumers. But yeah, I see what you mean, but I don't think that what I'm trying to say is that rather than go about and try and think, okay, what's a creative thing that I can do that's going to really persuade people to do something, I think what I'm trying to say is think before that. So before you think about the ad you create, because I agree there are adverts out there that are amazingly entertaining and creative and probably do act as a bribe, but I think the step before creating the ad, you should be thinking, okay, the bribe I'm going to create will be an amazing piece of content, an amazing advert, whatever that might be. If you aren't going to do that, then think of something else. But what I'm trying to say is, prior to the stage of making the advert, think about the bribe first, and then the advert might be the second thing you do. I mean, I know that is terribly weak, but I'm doing my best here.
Monica, what do you think about that? I said this is vicious. For God's sake, one of you's going out the balloon. What do you think about that?
Well, I think advertising's always been the art of either selling or the art of persuading. And we try and persuade in many ways and often emotive. So, I mean, bribery is probably the ultimate form of persuasion. So
the ultimate. Quote. The ultimate form of persuasion. Thank you very much, Monica.
Okay, nice. Yes, please. You sound like a yes voter in Scotland.
I understand this is the choice of...
I think we could grab the microphone, actually. And actually, a little notice has just come up here saying, with the microphone. It says, okay. No, hold on, it says, please make sure they use a microphone to ask their questions.
Okay, the question is, assume, even if it seems absurd to you and to the audience that vote for you, that people stop to be interested in bribes. No interest in bribes. And there is no hunger and no need to sort out this society.
Sounds like a John Lennon song.
Okay. So what do you think is left to advertising agencies at that point?
It's a bit like saying what is left to advertising agencies on Mars. Like, it's a bit of a bizarre question because the world's not like that. Unfortunately, there is hunger. Mm. And unfortunately, or fortunately, there is bribery. Thankfully for me, there is bribery. Well, it's hard to answer the question. I don't really...
I didn't answer the question. What happened?
I'm trying.
Honestly, it's a simple enough question. So what happens to advertising in a world where there is no hunger and there is no want and there is no bribery? Come on.
I mean, it is an excellent question. Let me make that clear. Thank you very much for the question. What happens in that world? I guess that one of the other answers wins and you get the right people up on stage. But unfortunately, the world is like that and bribery does exist and it is a great way of persuading people. I don't know what you think.
I think it does feel like an impossible place to go to. I mean, how amazing if that did happen and we could all just kind of, spend without a conscience. But I am struggling to imagine us ever getting there.
It's easy if you try. Culture is what is inflicted on you. It's absolutely true. I think we've got time for two more. Yeah? I can't see my... Yeah, please.
Hi. You've talked a lot about Ubuntu being about doing good, but is it really? It seems to be taxation without representation. Ubuntu seems to be a salve for a marketer's conscience, but actually all it does is add expense to a product, so we end up charging the consumer more. I'm not sure if it's any more moral than the bribery option.
I think Ubuntu is the idea that I am because of you, so seeing that kind of continuous link, that if I can grow the community around me, that's actually good for me to grow and prosper in the future as well. I don't think that the mechanism has to be added cost. It can be a partnership, so in my experience it was a partnership with for 30 years, franchisees contributing a percentage of their turnover
to a fund, as well as consumers making a contribution. That was not built into the price of the product. It's a choice outside of that. So I don't think it has to be a tax or an added cost, but it often gives people would like a way to help out, but they don't really know, so it gives them a channel to do that. And I think for me, it's more about, well, a lens. So what if we did look at the world that way? How could that shift or change the way we do things? And I think you could find, you know, part of the argument was that because we're in the business of brands and we'll find a profitable way to do that, we'll find many creative, innovative solutions to making that happen. So it doesn't necessarily have to come at a taxation or an extra cost to the consumer.
Can I just say that was an excellent question? Trying to put bribery and Ubuntu on the same level of morality is pretty good going. Thank you for that.
It's been done twice now. And one, look, who thinks they've got the definitive last question? Oh, is it somebody already got the microphone? You're going to choose, okay.
Okay. I've got, can I make one small point first and then a quick question?
Of course. Okay.
I think this might be answering your question down here, mate, but this is something I don't know you guys know more about. But isn't, if bribery, if you're trying to bribe me with something, it's got to be something I'm interested in, so it's relevance. And if it's Ubuntu, then it's got to be something it's relevant to you, it's a relevant interest. Maybe people don't give a fuck about the kids in Africa. And so with then it just goes, kind of alludes back to the Queen point you made earlier, where it's a relevance that we've got to be attached to. I suppose that's one point. And then the actual question, sorry, is for the main purposes of majority of businesses, it's about achieving growth. So how does Ubuntu and how does bribery, and I know you've both touched on it before, how does that help achieve growth?
Yeah, well, I think to your first point, you know, it doesn't have to be about kids in Africa. I think in the market that you operate in, it's about taking your business talent that then you're specifically good at and saying, how do I align that with the greatest societal need within the place that I operate? So in the UK, it could be youth unemployment through apprenticeship programs. It could be that way. And I think that what you'll end up doing is you'll galvanize consumers who are like-minded and who buy into your same values, and there'll be enough of that to go around. So it's okay to make choices and say, those people don't buy into my values, that's okay, but there'll be a mass of people who do. And I think that it generates growth because it gives you, you know, versus just buying a product, and I'm faced with these product choices, I'm actually making a statement about I buy into those values, and that's where that kind of reinforcing connection and that virtuous circle is created, and that's how you grow. So you connect more and you sell more.
From my point of view, I suppose that what I wasn't saying is that advertising can no longer work. And we heard at the start, Tim showed the I can't remember what the report's called, but it's all about how the effect that advertising has on the economy. So advertising does work. All I was saying was that if you want to make sure your ads get noticed, start with the bribe. And you're right, the bribe has to be relevant to the consumer. That is the most important thing. Once it's relevant to the consumer, you've got their attention, and then everything else you create around that, whether it's an advert or whether it's something else, some kind of communications campaign, that will help to contribute to the business and help contribute to the economy. So it's not that the advertising doesn't work, it's just a way of making sure the advert gets noticed in the first place.
Okay, one last sentence from each of you. Do you have one?
Please vote for her. You can't vote for me. That would be absolutely terrible.
I think for me, Ubuntu is not about being this high and lofty philosophy. It's just saying, you know, we as big corporates, we have these resources. Governments and NGOs are not doing the job. Why not channel that for good? And not make it not a CSI program that sits on the side, but really make it part of your core. And I think that's good for business and good for communities.
Thank you very much indeed. Well, I hope to God you get the voting this time, right this time, for the lady in the middle. Because you're all in big trouble if you don't. For Aidan, it's one and send. And for Monica, it's two and send. I can't remember, there's a television programme where they used to go, and will you do it now? What was that? Countdown. Countdown, was it? Oh, right, and that's come up. Votes are still coming in. We will let you know when the vote has closed. That's very helpful. Would you like to put anything else down here? It's some other kind of... at the end, by the way, I will be asking you a couple of feedback questions. So don't throw these things away. And by the way, incidentally, apparently each of these is worth £100, I'm told, yeah. Very hard to believe. No, don't put it in your bag. They don't work anywhere else, apparently. No, it's not a bribe. Incidentally, can anybody explain to me why the words trending hashtag didn't get used once today? I mean, has trending hashtag already untrended as a way? It has already. Oh, shit. I mean, it really is a problem. You only just become, you know, get abreast of the latest technology. You ask your kids to do it and so on and help you out. And by the time you've got it, it's changed. Okay, it says it, right. It was really close. The results will be brought down to you. That's me. And the winner is Monica Poole. Well done. And we have a special thing for, actually we have a special thing for everybody, but a particularly special gift for you, which is this.
Thank you.
I think everybody would like to know what it is. Tell them what it is.
It is a bottle of Tattinger champagne.
And where can you be found to share it with them afterwards?
Right up there.
And there's also one each for each of the others. So if we could... And what would be nice, should we take a photograph?
Okay.
A quick photograph. Don't go anywhere, everybody. We're just going to do a very quick photograph up here with these. I kind of hand them out.
See the other little things that's in the
winner. Oh, there's something else in there.
Oh, wow.
Right.
An envelope.
It
says BT Tower.
BT Tower.
You have won a visit to the BT Tower with up to 4 guests.
Yeah. That's good. That's good.
Great.
That's Thank good.
You. Thank you.
And the good news is that the 4 are that person there, that person there. Unfortunately, the lady there's just gone. She's gonna come. And the bloke who said he didn't give a fuck about the starving children, he's coming up as well. And the other good news is that the lifts are out of order. In the BT Tower. No, that's really good news. And here we have for you, yeah, please, for our runners-up who were brilliant. Tara, well done. You were terrific. For you, Victoria, well done. And for you. Yeah, thanks very much.
Thank you so well.
Okay, quick photograph. You face this way. Here he's over there. This is my best shirt, by the way. Well done. Great. Now, thank you very much. We have to do some feedback questions. Really important. Apparently, I don't get paid for this unless we do the feedback questions. So it's no, really, honestly, don't. So we have 2 questions which you're going to use these to feedback. You think you can escape without doing the feedback? Okay. Question, the first one, and you have 3 options for this. Are you now aware of why the AA exists? The answers you can give are, 1, yes, I am now very aware. 2, I'm a bit more aware. 3, no, I still don't understand why the AA exists. Okay, have you got that? 1, I'm now very, very aware. 2, I'm a bit more aware. And 3, no, I still don't understand why the AA exists. Nobody can see what you're voting, so if you come right the way down on the dimwit scale, nobody knows, and that's true, and that's helpful for them to know. And then you press 1, 2, or 3, and you press send. And if you could tell me when you've all done that, and then they could let me... Oh, it's got to come down here as totally a bit and not really. Totally, I don't say totally. Yeah, okay. And then they're going to let me know up there when you've finished voting on that one, and then there's a more complicated one. Am I finished here with this question? I am. Okay, brilliant. So the next one is, on a scale of 1 to 9, now you'll notice it's absolutely brilliant that there are 1 to 9, but you could press 0, but on a scale, well, what would that be? Actually, zero would be, Jesus wept, how did they get away with that? So actually, you've only got 1 to 9. 1 being poor and 9 being excellent, stroke, it says mind-blowing here. Which is, for those of you who are not over 50, mind-blowing means, you know, pretty good. It's kind of at the same period as groovy, if any of you have heard that. Which would be, groovy would be around about a 7. Anyway, but on a scale of 1 to 9, 1 being poor, 9 being excellent, how did you rate this event? Okay. I don't know what bribery, Aidan, we can give them to edge towards the 9, really. Yeah. Have you not got one? Have you not got it voted? 9. 9. Okay, so press the number you think is right for you, and then press send. Has everybody done that? Or are you still kind of thinking, oh, I'm a 6, but on the other hand, there was that bit, and that was kind of an 8, but oh, but you rather annoyed me with that joke, so that's 2. Have you all done it? Brilliant, thank you very much. That's now done. Please remind everyone to return their handsets, because as I said before, they're worth £100. Of course they're not worth £100. I could probably get you that from a market in Petticoat Lane for about £2. It would actually cause a fire, but nevertheless, we could get it for £2 and so on. So that's what we're going to do now. We're just going to wait. Are we going to wait to find out what the results are, though? You just want, that's just for your own. In that case, everybody, can I thank you very, very much for coming this evening. Thank you, Adrian. Have a safe trip home. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, David Aaronovitch, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.
Thank you all for coming.